Hey, we're talking about In the Lone Star Wars State, up next on Geek Out SA.
Do not attempt to adjust your YouTube video. We control the street.
Welcome back to Geek Out SA. It's Friday and we're having fun, and we have the Urban Journalist with us. Yay! Again. Hey! Been so long. This has been like from before.
I think
was it before COVID?
No. Because we saw I filmed with y'all in September of 2020, an episode here. We had to wear the masks.
Yes.
And that's then, right.
I was promoting Sci-Fi Turner's 5-year reunion, and then we filmed in November of 2020 for something that we're showing today.
Yeah.
So we've seen him, but not a lot. We were sequestered for such a long time, like. So it's nice to see.
I would always see you guys, and I'm like, oh my gosh, I want to get to you. You reached out to me, not that you're like, we need to get together soon. I was like, I know.
So. Now that we can all get out and about again, we can get together and do stuff. Because you don't even know, like the three of us used to like, go to cons, and we would do all kinds of stuff, and we would go out and have dinner. And
I've known you guys 7 years now. That's so crazy. And I feel like
I'm still getting to
you. We've known each other for 7 years. Yeah. That's crazy.
Time flies when you're having fun.
Yes.
And then, especially for the love of Star Wars that we all have.
Yes. We may have a slightly deeper problem than...
Yeah, I love your shirt.
Thank you.
I love your shirt.
Well, yeah,
we're wearing it.
This was not planned.
Not at all. This was not planned.
It was accidental. Well, I had seen a couple episodes ago you were wearing it. I was like, okay, he's probably not going to wear it. And then I was like, you know what? I bought it a year ago.
I was actually going to wear the one that she's wearing but there's yellow and green
there's
on
too
it.
Much
and
yellow
I can't
and
wear
green.
It on
it
this.
It blends with the background.
Yeah.
Well, I got it a year ago, and I had not worn it. I was like, I'll probably wear it for something in the documentary. And I was like, I can wear this today. And then I bought this tie in 2016, and I never worn it. And I was like, I can wear it today. So I guess the tie breaks it off.
Well, it would have been funnier, because it was supposed to be he was going to wear this one, and I was going to wear that one. So you and I would have been like twinsies right next to each other.
Great minds think alike. It's epic.
There we go.
Well, you are always like a fashionista. It's one of the things that like I love about you,
thank you.
You can take like geeky fashion to another level. Mm-hmm. So a lot of the times he and I are just t-shirt and jeans, right? For these things. And so we didn't want a t-shirt and jeans it.
Oh, well, I love your sandals. I wish there was a shoe cam. Very Death Star.
That's what I thought.
Did you when you saw the one that we did about
I saw the fashion one.
You saw the fashion one.
So cool.
You got to see my custom shirt.
Yes.
So that was a cool thing that Colleen did for me.
Yeah, I loved that, like finding the pattern, then getting someone to make the custom shirt for him. Because there is a lot of fabric out there nowadays, but you've even gone so far as like having the fabric printed for you.
So for the documentary, there is a lot of fashion. And a lot of it, I use fashion as a form. In the documentary, we use fashion as a form.
Well, let's bring up the poster.
Okay.
Let's bring up a poster and then we'll talk about that. So that sweater.
Yes.
I haven't seen that anywhere.
So that was actually custom made for me. Okay. It was made by Teresa Gonzalez. She has this awesome boutique called Bois. I think you've met her.
I think so.
She was in my last documentary, Sci-Fi Tonians. And so we filmed I needed it because we were filming in 7 days. And usually it takes her about 2 months or 3 months. And I called her up in October of 2020. I said, hey, I'm going to be filming. I want this sweater, and I sent her a sketch of what I wanted. Can you make it happen? And she did. And I wanted, because we were going to be filming inside of a theater, and I wanted color, and I wanted it to pop. And so, yeah, it's very bright. It's beautiful. I've only worn it just for that, but I love it. It's fun. And so in the documentary, I do wear a lot of custom fashion, because for men, they always forget about us, you know. Now they're starting to get more shirts cool stuff. And getting more creative. But for a while, it was just her universe for women.
Yes.
And so for my documentary, a lot of what I wear is custom. It's designed by me, and I partner with my dear friend Stephanie Dowd, who just constructed everything, and my friends at Next Day Custom Print, who I said, I need this. Can you print this? And so there's a lot of fashion in the store.
I love your jacket. Your jacket is one of my like favorite pieces of all time.
There's the Darth Maul one.
No, the other one.
There's a Topps, the Topps coat one, which is a long red coat.
Yeah.
That has the Topps, which was the 1980s trading cards.
And that's what I I like the nod to that as well. And don't you have some stuff that's a nod to some of the toys as well?
There is the Kenner coat.
A Kenner.
The Kenner coat. That one was fun to making. Yep. So.
Very cool. Oh, we have Steve. He says, hey guys, happy Friday.
Hey, what's up, Steve?
How's it going?
So yeah, people who may not know, now I'm hoping that they know to look for that stuff, because those are some of those little things within the film that you have to look for those nuances, right, if you aren't aware of them.
And,
so,
and it's a fun, I always say fashion is another form of storytelling, and we're using fashion as a way to further illustrate the narrative.
Right.
I know, so it's also a wink to those original hardcore fans. It's kind of like saying, I got you.
Yeah, I like that.
Cool.
I like that a lot.
Cool. Yeah, no, I'm getting more into the fashion of it. And these aren't
You look
cheap.
Great. I love your look.
And these aren't cheap.
They were like $58.
Yeah, I mean, you can't buy them at like Walmart or anything.
No. Yeah. I like the quality. There's a great brand called Dumb Goods.
Mm-hmm.
And it's high quality licensed merchandise. And they've done stuff with Blockbuster, with Nickelodeon. And I like their bowling shirts, Matrix, Power Rangers, Mean Girls. I mean, anything you could think of that is out there that is popular, they do some really awesome stuff.
What I think did really well was the Mark Echo line of the Star Wars stuff. Mm-hmm. I have a couple of t-shirts of that I won't
there's
ever
also
let go of.
High fashion things, which is what I love, because people think of Star Wars and these sort of subjects as sort of like geeky, and these people are not fashionable and they eat Taco Bell, but it's like,
right.
But it's like I like Taco Bell,
which we do, but still
but like, you know, you have Christian Louboutin, which, you know, a pair of shoes will run you up to like $700. Well, I wish they were $700, now they're like almost like $1,000. But he did a collaboration when The Last Jedi came out of shoes. Coach has done some stuff.
Coach has some things.
Gucci did some stuff for Disney. Louis Vuitton. It's great, because it's almost like the lines of elitism have been blurred.
Right.
And that's great.
Well, I think it's because a lot of these celebrities have started to come out nowadays and say, look, this was part of my childhood too. And this is what like maybe led me to be an actor or led me to be a film star. And I'm like secretly playing D&D at my house or like painting miniatures. And so again, it's blurred those lines, because those people who have the money to pay for those designers have said, hey, this is kind of where I'm at. And they're like in our age bracket. So, you know, then we're starting to get some of the nicer things to wear. So it isn't just t-shirts all the time and stuff. So I wanted to talk about your poster again really quickly while we had the poster up. So the poster, aside from your sweater, is a nod to something else.
So for the first teaser trailer, I really thought very thoroughly about it. In September of 2020, I reached out to the Santikos Entertainment Group, which they own a lot of the movie theaters here in town. And I said, you know, I have a great relationship with them. Throughout the documentary, I filmed, you know, whenever they released a new Star Wars movie, I filmed at their venues. And I reached out and I said, you know, I need shots of people hanging out at the movie theater watching Star Wars. Because with documentaries, oftentimes, a lot of it is conversational. And I'm very visual, and I wanted to do something entertaining. And so I wanted footage to reference to some of the conversations about people going to the movies. And we filmed that in September of 2020. They gave me the IMAX. They were very generous. They gave me 2 hours at the IMAX on a Saturday morning at 7 o'clock. I'm not a morning person, but it was worth it. And I had so much fun filming that. I decided, wow, I could make a teaser out of this, like a fun teaser. And so we came back in November. We filmed a teaser, and that's where I got you guys involved.
That was fun.
I wrote a little script, and I was like, okay, I can get them involved. And the teaser is an inspiration to the 1990s teaser trailers and the early, mid-2000s teaser trailers. Back then, movie trailers, when they would come out, they didn't have any footage of the film. It was usually like something very artistic where it had the actor or the actress talking about the movie, and it was usually, they would release it usually during the summer for the next summer.
Right, right.
And Pixar was notorious for that. Charlie's Angels, the first film, the Mac G 2000 version, had that. And so it was a nod to that, but also a nod to the fact that the concept of the blockbuster as we know it, we think we say blockbusters now, but we don't really know the history of it. The concept of the blockbuster was really born in the 1970s with films like The Godfather, mm-hmm. The Exorcist, Jaws was a big one. I mean, I wasn't born anywhere near there, but I know the history. And of course, George Lucas's Star Wars was a big part of that. And so it was called the blockbuster because there was a lot of people lining up at Twin Theaters. And so it's sort of a nod. I also feel like the movie theater industry is at a very delicate point right now. Mm-hmm. And so I wanted to remind people of the beauty of what that is. I'm a big movie theater advocate. Yeah. I still buy Blu-rays, not digital. I still buy Blu-rays and I still go watch it. Even if it's online, I'll go watch it at the cinema because it's like going to church for me. So we filmed here in San Antonio, part of the teaser. And then we filmed some of it in Dallas, the exterior of it in Dallas. And we filmed at the Texas Theater, which is where they found the guy that murdered John F. Kennedy Sr. Oh. What was his name?
Oswald.
Oswald. Yeah. Where they found him. And so they were very generous at the Texas Theater, and they let us film the exterior there for this.
That's really cool. So a little Texas history
This documentary is as much about Texas as it is about Star Wars. And, you know, our slogan is, they say everything's bigger in Texas, and Star Wars is no exception.
And I love that because I think a lot of the time, I love Texas. You know, I'm born and bred. You've gotten to enjoy it.
I feel like I'm from here. Yeah, I'm from Puerto Rico, but I call myself a Texan.
And so a lot of times I think we get this bad rap of, not that we're like hillbillies and we're hicks and we ride our, you know, horse to town or whatever, you know, and we don't have any couth and we don't know anything. And so to see the fandom from all the different perspectives that we're going to get to see.
So we see it in Houston, Austin, Dallas, San Antonio, outskirt towns like Orange, Texas. And the cool thing is doing this project, there is a lot of connection to science fiction and Star Wars in Texas. And I filmed at the Bob Bullock Museum in Austin, where they did this awesome exhibition about tracing that history. Nice. And it's so amazing because the Lone Ranger, there's a post in one of the iconic books from, like, I think it's the 60s or the 70s, where even the pose of Tonto and the Lone Ranger is similar to the pose of Han Solo and Chewbacca. And Lone is English for Solo. Solo is Spanish for lone. And it was so interesting seeing Princess Leia, her outfit is inspired by the women of the Mexican Revolution.
Yes.
Even the bandoliers and everything. So it's so interesting seeing all these connections to Texas. And when I found out about that, I was just so excited about it.
That's very cool. Yeah. No, I really enjoy that. Regina says it's a really cool poster. The more you look at it, the more little details pop out.
Yes, yes. So. I don't eat that much at a movie theater. I use usually a tub of candy and a soda. And it depends. Recently, I've been eating more hot dogs at the movie theater, but I don't eat candy. But I thought it was just a cool nod to that. So
yeah.
And the Stormtroopers is actually one Stormtrooper. They were duplicated. That was done in a studio. But that was, and so the cup is actually a Panda Express cup. And we, because I wanted red, I wanted, again, to go to that Americana, element of things that we.
So we've filmed with him, and he's real finicky about his props. You don't even know.
Yeah, I am.
But it's good.
And my takes. How many times do we have to do takes? You guys are so patient. I remember when we filmed with you, it was in, they're also in the documentary. They're in the documentary, but they're in this teaser. When we filmed the teaser, it was still, there was no vaccine. There was conversation of a vaccine. It was November 2020, early November. And I felt so bad. It was a big, giant IMAX venue, but we still couldn't hug. We couldn't shake hands. We couldn't see each other. And I saw you guys from a distance, and I wanted to run up and hug y'all. And, like, and we couldn't. And so we had to wear a mask. And so, and usually my tradition is when we do something cool, like I like to go to dinner, I like to get together, mm-hmm. and we couldn't even do that. So it was so
no,
great.
No, because I remember you had to like stagger us. It looks good, right? Because it looks like we're filling up the theater, and it probably it would have worked anyway, right? But he had to stagger us for COVID, and like things were like taped off and stuff already by the theater.
I can't wait to see some.
I'm excited, like, because we're friends, you know, he sent us a little bit.
You saw it?
You've seen the trailer. You've sent us, like, oh, this is something I'm editing right now or whatever. You'll send us, like, little, like, 20-second things here and every now and again, and I'm just like, I'm so excited.
And I remember for the interior stuff, which was shot here in San Antonio, my friend Greg Risley was the one that filmed it, and I was directing him, and he was so patient because I'm much of a perfectionist, and I just kept like, hey, can we do this one more time?
But it turns out so great. So if people have not gone and seen Sci-Fi-tonians, that is a documentary that Alejandro has already done and is out there, and you can see that. So that is something you should definitely go and see so that you can see the work that you put into it.
It's amazing.
When Vincent and I went, and we didn't know you at the time, and we didn't really know you, and we were like...
thought it was trash. No.
Well, yes. No. Beforehand, we were like, okay, we're going to go do this to be nice to this kid, right? And he's, like, making this film, right? And we're totally into Fandom, so we're like, we'll have him on the show. Yeah. You know, we'll be good, because that's our... that's our thing, right?
Yeah, you guys have always been inclusive.
We want to like encourage people and stuff, and then we're sitting there in the theater, and we're like, "Shut up! Look at this thing. It's good. We really enjoyed it." And we're like, "Ooh, good. Look at this kid!"
But I think it was more of a reason of we thought the content was going to be a little different than it was.
Agreed. Yeah.
And I think that's where we went into it with the problem. Mm-hmm. And then when we actually saw it, it was like it had nothing to do with what we thought it had to do with.
Well, but I love that. I don't ever want people to expect something. I want people to be surprised, because I think the moment they figure you out, it's like it's not entertaining.
Yeah.
So
I was definitely
like, I'm pretty sure you didn't think I was going to wear a lightsaber tie today. You know,
I did not. I did not see this outfit for you at all. So I was like, nice. I like it.
Yeah.
So I think if you haven't seen that, and if you're gearing up and getting ready to see his new documentary, you should definitely go check out Sci-Fi-tonians. And we'll put some links to that up so that you can go watch it.
Since we're here, we should show off the teaser, since we're going to air here first.
First, because it airs at 9 o'clock. On my page, but you guys get to see it first. Plus, you guys get an exclusive clip of the documentary that is not going to be anywhere.
Ooh,
so,
yes. Okay, let's see.
We're ready. Cue that up.
Hi, one for Star Wars, please, George.
Best movie in the galaxy.
Thank you very much.
Hi, how are you? How can I help you?
Hi, happy May 4th.
Here to see Star Wars?
Star Wars.
Great choice. Enjoy.
Thank you.
George, one ticket for Star Wars!
Oh, Star Wars, the best movie ever. I love Chewbacca. Enjoy.
Thank you. Bye.
The child doesn't even go here!
They say everything's bigger in Texas. If I've learned anything these past couple of years in filming my documentary, is that Star Wars is no exception. You be the judge.
Yeah,
no, that was really good. That was awesome.
Yes.
That was amazing.
It was a bit avant-garde.
Because no, I
wanted to do something different. You do get some clips from the movie, as you saw. They're very quick.
I don't think it's too avant-garde. I guess maybe because I'm older.
Yeah.
I miss that kind of trailer.
Yeah.
I am so sick of these trailers that I've seen the whole movie once I've seen the trailer, yeah. Right? I'm so sick of that. I want something like this.
Yeah.
That gets me excited for the movie, but doesn't tell me too much of the story.
Correct.
So that I can go into it and be excited. Like, yeah. And I'm excited just because I've been watching you on this journey, but I'm also excited because this is a big part of our lives.
Yeah.
You know, like, this is our childhood, right?
Yeah.
This is like toys that are still buried in my mom's front yard somewhere because that was what we did, you know? They had, you know, wars and they fought and the stormtroopers died and they got buried. You
know? Very Rogue One out of it.
Copies that we've taken on just because we love it so much, like me building lightsabers.
Yeah.
So it's a ton of things to us and it's a story that needs to be told.
I think back in the 70s and the 80s when these movies were around and some of us did love them, it wasn't cool to love them.
Correct.
Right? And so we weren't treated very nicely. And there were little pockets of our friends who loved them. But now your documentary is going to show us how many people there are out there that are like us, that enjoy the same thing. And it's a nice thing. There's so much negativity in the world. And this is just like a nice thing.
Well, I think that was one thing that I loved about this experience. I've been filming since September 3rd, 2015. It was at Force Friday when they launched the first toys for Force Awakens.
Mm-hmm.
I remember
that too.
One of the beautiful things about this experience and this journey is just seeing how, you know, religion is divisive, politics is divisive, even what one makes financially is divisive. Mm-hmm. But the beautiful thing about Star Wars and what I find so interesting is that something that's designed for children ultimately has the ability of uniting people from all walks of life, all ages. I'm 32 and I've made friends with people who are like 50, people who are 60, people who are in their 40s, you know, like, and meeting people from all different belief systems, people who believe the pandemic is fake, people who believe it's real. It doesn't matter what we believe because we have Star Wars in common. And the beautiful thing about it is just really been how this thing has united. And we see people from walks of life. We meet in the documentary, there's a law enforcement agent from Houston who we go with him and you see the horrors that, you know, he sees in a day. And, you know, he dresses up as a stormtrooper on weekends and is part of the 501st and brings hope to children with cancer. We meet one of my favorite and dear friend, Heather Trupia, who lives in Buda, which is outside of Austin. She is a teacher at a Title I school, and she uses Star Wars to, Title I is usually a low socioeconomic school environment, and she uses Star Wars to inspire her students, and she uses it to promote literacy and everything, and another great story is, I mean, so many people, but one of the other ones is Lance Hathaway, who lives in Orange, Texas. There's nothing going on in Orange, Texas. I drove 6 hours, and I usually like to stay in a comfortable hotel, and I had to stay at a Holiday Inn. Nothing wrong with that, but, like, you know, I stayed at a Holiday Inn with truckers, and there wasn't even a Walmart there. That's how there's nothing there. And he is, they're right at the border of Louisiana. And his house flooded two times. One time during Hurricane Harvey and another time because of the area that they're in. And it's so beautiful how he still kept rebuilding his Star Wars Death Star themed home theater over and over again.
Wow.
And he's dealt with some stuff that we explore in the documentary, and it was so beautiful how Star Wars, and you said we're living in very challenging times, mm-hmm. but there's something beautiful about Star Wars, and it gives us hope, it connects us, and you know, it's the hero's journey, and it's our story in many different ways.
Yeah, and I think so many of us can relate with, there's all of these different characters that have had to get past these things in their lives and have had to try and to try again and to try again and to fall and to get up, you know. So I think that resonates with us too. So I don't know. I love the beauty of Star Wars to me.
There's times where I've been dealing with something in my life, and my favorite is, of course, The Empire Strikes Back. And I'll pop it in, and those scenes with Yoda and Luke and those life lessons.
Mm-hmm.
And it helps me, you know, okay, great, okay, I'm going through. I mean, it's in space and everything, but it's like there's relatable elements
to these
characters. And there's something very powerful. I mean, not many films nowadays and over time have transcended the way, and I think it's because it's a very authentic human story.
Right.
I would agree with that. Yeah, I would agree with that.
So I wanted to ask you, so what are your views on what they're starting to do with Star Wars now?
I mean, I think the Walt Disney Group is a corporation, you know, and they love money.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I think they went in hard when they did the prequel trilogy. I enjoyed it. I mean, the sequel trilogy.
I enjoyed it.
I enjoyed it very much. The third one's my favorite. I mean, the Rise of Skywalker is my favorite. But yes, there were some things that they really didn't have a plan. And I think the great thing about what they're doing now is that with Rogue One, with The Mandalorian, now Obi-Wan, they're realizing that what fans love about it is those nostalgic elements. And I like how they still introduce new things, but they still connect it back. And they're taking their time. And I mean, Dave Filoni and the director from Elf. I forget his name. What's his name?
Favreau? No.
He's friends with Jennifer. I think he's friends with Jennifer Aniston.
I don't remember any of their names. I'm really bad with celebrity people. But,
he directed the first Iron Man.
Favreau.
Favreau.
I was like,
what they're doing is so amazing. And it's still profitable. But they're still being respectful.
But they're fans.
They're fans, and that's, I think, the secret to this is you have to be a fan to understand these worlds and everything.
And I love that The Mandalorian's bringing us those elements of, like, cowboys in Texas, like we've seen in the past.
It's the good and the bad, the ugly. We talk about it in the documentary. Mm-hmm. It's still, but George Lucas was notorious for that. He even mimicked scenes from Akira Kurosawa films. He mimicked scenes from The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly. I mean, and in our documentary, you see them side by side. So I just think that it's great that they're sort of doing that. And I don't know. I'm excited for Obi-Wan.
Yes. We are too. We're excited for Obi-Wan.
I'm like waiting for that one to come already. I'm just like, why can't it be on May
already?
4th?
They pushed it. Yeah, they pushed it.
They pushed it. Yeah. And I was but they could have released it on May the 4th.
They could have. That would have been perfect. Yeah. But that's what we're here. We're celebrating May the 4th.
Because so much has been coming out,
yeah.
Are you having a hard time wrapping up the documentary because there's so many chances for... No?
No. So what delayed the documentary, I was originally intended to release in 2021. It was going to be in May of 2021. COVID happened. So summer of 2020, I was going to take care of everything, whatever was left. And then COVID happened. I still continued working on the documentary, but doing interviews with people that I knew were taking precaution. And it was a bit challenging. And so last year really was the year where I really hit things into high gear and traveled all over Texas and filmed whatever I had to film. I think there's the beautiful thing about the time that we've had with this project is that we touch on, so a lot of people don't know this, but The Rise of Skywalker was really the last blockbuster as we know it. Because January came, yeah, you had Birds of a Prey and Bad Boys, but you know, these movies don't draw the same amount as Star Wars. And then the pandemic happens. And then everything is going straight to streaming, and movie studios are getting greedy. AMC's on the verge of bankruptcy, and movie theaters are shutting down left and right. And it's a topic that I talk about in the documentary, because we talk about, you see when The Force Awakens comes out, you see it there in real time. You see when The Last Jedi comes out in real time, and then you see in real time when the Rise of Skywalker comes out. And then you see what happens after. Yeah. That's a very emotional topic for me, because to me, movie theaters are, they represent to me, I grew up going to the movies. They were such a huge part of my childhood.
Us too.
And to me, it's church. And there's nothing more that I love than on a Thursday evening, going to the movies by myself. People think it's weird. But going to the movies, and you go there, and you're transformed. And it's an industry, socially, we need it. We need movie theaters.
Yes.
You know,
well, we grew up at the tail end of the time where you used to even dress up to go to the theater.
Correct.
Like, it was an event. Yeah, it was an event. Like, you dressed in your nice clothes and you went, and, you know, it was still, you know, it was a lot to get, like, the snacks and stuff if your mom didn't hide them in her purse and get them from H&B or whatever, you know. And so it was a big event for the family. And then, you know, there was the whole, like, sneaking into the theaters and stuff like that.
I never dared do that.
You didn't?
No.
We did, like, as teenagers. Like, I think you want to feel like a rebel, you know? And so you got to go sneak in and stuff. And
but we talk about that. And we talk about the streaming services. And, you know, I believe in physical media. Because what people don't know is that everything digital, you don't own it.
Nope.
You don't own anything. Yep, and there's in fine print right there when you buy, like, let's say, like, I'm buying the new Spider-Man before it comes out on DVD, or the new Batman.
Yep.
It says so right there. They can take it away. And there's been cases where they've taken it away.
Yeah.
And not only that, but they track your information. Mm-hmm. And there's something so powerful about going to a movie theater. I remember going to see the Avengers Endgame. I didn't know. I went by myself. Opening night. I didn't know anybody there. But it was such an experience because everybody was clapping, everybody was cheering, and I don't know you, but what's up? You know, like, we're having this experience together, and you feel great, and it doesn't matter what's going on in your life, as opposed to when you're home and you're watching it on your phone, and oh, I gotta do the dishes, or oh, I gotta do this.
Yeah. Yes.
And to me, it's a church. It's just, it's amazing.
Well, that was like when we went to go see Spider-Man. And
I was so happy
because there's so many nods to things from the past. Yeah. And when we were in the theater, it was those moments where people are cheering and we're like, oh my God, like that guy's there, you know, and we all get to experience that together. And we're like, yes, we all love this. And there's that collaborative. Right. And then, like you said, you watch it at home and you're like, well, I'm going to pause it and go to the bathroom. And whereas at the theater, you're like, I can't go to the bathroom. This is like so cool, you know, and you're like, oh, I've got to go to deal with the dog or go do the dishes. And, you know, you're not giving the film
your
time. You're taking yourself out of the experience.
Well,
yeah.
What I loved about Spider-Man was that Spider-Man No Way Home was really the first film where things started to feel normal in terms of going to the cinema.
Yes.
Because you had movies that had come out. I mean, Wonder Woman 1984, James Bond, which is one of my favorites. I saw that 5 times. But there's certain movies that draw a certain audience. And I remember I went in December to see Spider-Man No Way Home. And I love that cheering and that excitement and people clapping. And, you know, that was, to me, that there was hope. And even recently with the Batman, with Robert Pattinson's Batman, I was upset because the movie was doing so well. And they announced before the movie came out that it was going to come out on HBO Max in April. And it's just like, to me, that's just greedy. And it's like art. You've got to go to a museum to see the Mona Lisa. You've got to go to the museum to see a Warhol. It's not the same watching it on your phone. It's an experience because you're standing in front of that thing, the original thing. You're part of that history. And there's just certain things like, you know.
And didn't you used to rate movies on, like, this is how we used to rate movies. So this is a, like, I'm seeing it in the real theater, like, where it costs money. And then this one looks good and fun, but I'm going to see it in the dollar theater, right?
Yeah.
And then this one looks okay and fun, but I'm going to wait until it's at Blockbuster or whatever, right?
I still watch all of them.
That was how we used to kind of rate the movies, and that was, like, our rating system for it. It was like, if I'm going to pay the primo money and drag all the three kids and get all the snacks and stuff, right, it's going to be that movie that I think is going to be awesome. And if I think it's going to be okay, I'm just going to wait. I'm going to wait a few months, and it's going to get there to the dollar theater. And there wasn't all of this social media and stuff where everybody was spoiling everything for you, so you still got to go and experience the movie.
I'm so glad that it's so hard for them to do that with Disney. Any of Disney stuff.
To leak anything?
Yeah.
It's hard, but one thing that happened a lot because of streaming during the pandemic and during these last couple months was there was a lot of pirating going on. Scarlett Johansson famously sued the Walt Disney Group, and I was so happy. And people were like, how greedy, like, she's a millionaire. This is not about the millions. It's about the money that she was promised. I mean, they tried to screw her. She's a big A-list celebrity. They tried to screw over. The group that produced The Matrix, they're suing because they bought. I mean, I enjoyed it. Was it the best? No. But I enjoyed it. Mm-hmm. And, you know, there was all this revenue that could have come. I have Disney Plus, but I still have the Blu-ray copies of everything. I only watch Disney Plus because it's Mandalorian. And then I was a big Lizzie McGuire fan, and they talked about a reboot, and it never happened. but I mean, we're seeing also now the other end of it. Netflix stock has gone down because they're getting greedy. Yeah. They're raising all these prices. And I just feel like corporations in America right now are really, not a political statement, but they're really hurting the everyday, you know, hardworking person. But the great thing is everybody's rising and saying, you know, making their voices heard. So that's also a beautiful thing about this time.
Yeah, because we were really worried about theaters, and it seems like a lot of us who have that nostalgia and stuff, we have kind of raised our voices and said, hey, like, y'all need to come and give us some of these movies, especially if you want me to pay $40 to stream it at my house. You know, the kids that want to do that, the millennials and stuff, they love that.
Yeah.
Go right ahead if that's what you want to do.
But what are we losing?
But give me the option.
What are we losing socially?
Yeah. Oh, yes.
You know,
as an educator,
skills,
I see it. I see it all the time. They can't even sit through a 2-hour movie. Forget about it.
Yeah.
It's getting worse. Yeah. Tons worse. But you brought us a gift.
You brought us an extra
clip that's not going to be aired anywhere. So you're going to see it only here.
On Geek Out SA.
On Geek Out SA.
So we have an exclusive clip from the documentary. I'm gonna give you a little bit of an insight real quick. So we're going to meet Chris Kelly, who is a collector from Austin, Texas. In 2005, his collection grew so much. They lived in a modest suburb in Austin. His collection grew so much that they couldn't walk anywhere in the house. And they ended up having to buy a property in the country in Dripping Springs, which is a little small town outside of Austin. Filming in that place was sensory overload because he has everything, you know, toothbrushes from the 70s. I'm a 90s kid, so, you know, but even stuff from the 90s is there. And everywhere and I say this with all love and respect, he is a Star Wars hoarder in the best way possible.
Nice.
Everywhere you look, it's like there's something Star Wars. There's even condoms. I don't know if I can say that.
Yeah, you can say that. That's
there's
okay.
even Star Wars condoms and credit cards. And I did get the luxury. He invited me several times to sleep over while I was filming because these were long filming sessions. And I felt like I was waking up at a Toys R Us. So it was like my 90s dream.
Nice, nice.
So he has it divided by vintage Star Wars collection and modern Star Wars collection. You're about to see a little piece of his Star Wars modern collection.
Follow me into my modern day Star Wars collection, where I have hung a 6.5-foot Naboo fighter from Toys R Us. It was a Toys R Us store display from the ceiling. Picked it up on Craigslist, bought it, and had it installed from the roof. Each of these is a different series that I collected over the years. But you've got everything from, you know, Episode 3 over here, Saga, 30th anniversary with all the points, the vintage collection, I've got Clone Wars, you know, I've got the Episode 2, Power of the Jedi, all the way over to Episode 1. So it all started by year and kind of flows throughout the entire room. I kind of wanted it to feel like I was back in Walmart or Target at the time, to be able to see what it would look like to have the whole collection at once offered, along with ships, deluxe vehicles, beast packs, any of the stuff that came out at the time, cantina scenes, whatever, cinema scenes.
That's the stuff I remember vividly growing up. Dad would get the one in the package, the one loose, and then the third one that was for me. Being able to see it in the package the way it was when I got it still, that's really cool.
I'll give myself a letter grade of an A for being a collector. As far as my love and passion for it, I will collect just about anything that makes me happy.
People don't really get it unless they see this. This is a huge collection where, you know, you say, oh, my husband collects Star Wars stuff or Star Wars toys. Oh, okay. It's usually not a big deal until they see it.
My friends will come over and I'll be like, you want to go see my dad's stuff? And then they're like, oh, this is really cool for the first 5 minutes. And then they're like, that's a lot of stuff. Oh my gosh. And they get like a little overwhelmed and you're like, I told you, it's a lot of stuff. Like they don't really believe how much there is.
That's just making a mess. And you thought we collected a lot of stuff. Yeah.
That was a lot.
I have the Jar Jar Binks. We have a cup.
Here. I remember that was 1999 Taco Bell.
Yep.
It was Taco Bell.
Taco and Bell, I had, Pizza Hut, or...
Because they all of them did something, and they were doing those cups. And yep. I had the pot racer, and I had also the Darth... No, I didn't have the Darth Maul one, because my mom said he resembled Satan.
Oh, yes.
And we grew up very Catholic, and we were Catholic school kids, and so we couldn't have that.
No Satan in the house.
Yeah.
Well, he does get split in half, so, you know.
So that was awesome.
That's going to be beautiful just to get to see. I love how you're just letting everybody tell their story.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. They've been married for 25 years, by the way. They are both from California, from the San Francisco Bay. And I love that because they have, I think it's four or five children. And I love that because there's this stereotype out there that if you collect stuff like this, you're like Steve Carell's character in The 40-Year-Old Virgin.
Yes.
And a lot of these people, you know, are very well off. Some of them are retired.
Uh-huh.
And we meet a lot of collectors.
We've been waiting till adulthood till we had the money to get all this.
Yeah. And I love Chris. I love his family. We've become really great friends. And it's so cool, again, going back to the connection of Star Wars, we're different generations. We grew up in different times, but we solely connected on this Star Wars thing, and it'll get to the point where sometimes, like, I'll call them up, hey, what are you doing? Let's go catch a movie. They'll come to San Antonio, or I'll come up there to Dripping Springs. I've stayed at their place many times, and we have an amazing, like with you guys, we have an amazing, genuine friendship and relationship, and I love that.
That's so good.
Very cool. Very cool. Well, everybody's going to ask me, and they're going to be asking when to come and out.
Yeah. So there is a release date that I'm working towards. It's either going to be, you guys know which one it is. It's either going to be, right now we're in the editing phase. It's very like rigorous and intense.
Yes, people have no clue.
Yes, and I'm filming some stuff, just small, minor stuff, nothing big. But it's either going to come out in early fall or late fall. But it's coming out this year, 2022. And I'm excited. I'm really excited about it.
Yeah. And you're going to debut it in a theater.
It's going to go on YouTube, but we're going to do a premiere in the theater. I want to do a premiere here in San Antonio. And then I fell in love with the Texas theater so much because I love the Kennedys. I love the history. And I love that theater. So Art Deco. And so I wanted to do a premiere there in Dallas as well.
Nice.
So you guys we'll are going to travel.
Yes.
Yeah.
We will go to both.
Yeah, definitely hitting both.
I guess I have to grow my hair again so I can do my Princess Leia buns.
And it'll be themed. It'll be fashion themed.
Oh, okay, good. So I'm going to start getting my swagger on right now.
I already have rules. No sneakers, no t-shirts. I know you're good.
I'm ready. So, I'm excited.
Yeah.
So that's going to be awesome. I can't wait to see it. I can't wait for the date. I'm waiting for it.
You guys are throughout the story. And I was so excited to include you because when we met when I released High Five 20th, and I'm thinking, crap, I wish I would have known them before, because I would have interviewed them and put them in the story. And you hit a lot of, you have so much passion, and you touch on so many things.
I tend to be a little bit over the top.
And you were great. You were amazing. And so I was like, I need my Geek Out people in there. So.
And we've sent him like all film us, like when we were watching like the trailer for the movies that came out.
Yes,
and like, I mean, we were just in tears. And then
the documentary is also, I think what inspired me to make it was, I always wondered, I'm a 90s kid, so I always wondered what that moment in 1977 was like. And I always loved to travel back in time. And so I wanted to, I felt like this moment in 2015 when they were releasing the films was historical. And so I wanted to capture that moment. So it's also a time capsule of these last couple of years of Star Wars. Yeah.
I like that a lot. Yeah.
Very cool.
That's nice.
Well, Alejandro, it's awesome to have you.
Always a privilege. And happy May 4th ahead of time.
May the 4th be with you.
May the 4th be with you all.
Yes. And also with you.
With you. Yes, yes.
Since you're Catholic. But thanks for checking us out. I really appreciate it. If you haven't clicked on that subscribe button, hit on that subscribe button. Click up the notification bell so the next time we go live, you know. But thanks for checking it out. Checking us out. I'm Vince.
I'm Colleen.
And I'm Alejandro Cabrera.
And Aaron over there.
Geek out of there.
So bad.
We're so killing it.